Ever since I wanted to play guitar, when I was about 13, you know, I asked my parents for a guitar for Christmas, and they kind of thought, you know, that's strange, but they got it for me.
It's like this thing you get at Sears, you know, $30, you get the guitar and the amp. I was really excited, I had no idea how to play it, but I got it plugged in, and I just sat there on the low E string for hours and drove my parents absolutely insane.
And, wanted to learn how to play, and went and took a lesson. And the guy said, girls don't play rock and roll. I give a damn about my reputation. I've never been afraid of any deviation. And I don't really care if I'm strange. I ain't gonna change. And I'm never gonna care about my bad reputation. Wallow. No, not me. Wallow. Growing up in the 70s, it was sort of a feminism, and I didn't think that it would be such a big deal for a girl to try to play rock and roll. I'd start reading about this club, probably when I was 12. Rodney Bingenheimer's English Disco.
He was the first to play records by Blondie, the Ramones, Sex Pistols, and Nirvana, to name a few. Yeah, baby, your
hair's all right. They play Bowie, and they play T-Rex, Iggy Pop, Susie Quattro, who I'd never heard of, who's this girl playing bass. It was a disco for teenagers. If you were like 21, you were already too old. Though, rock stars of that era would come in. I was a naive kid, so going to Hollywood, it was a big night out. I talked some kids to come with me, and there were guys and girls with tons of makeup on and crazy hairdos and lots of glitter and really short skirts and dresses and fishnets, and it was just, what the fuck is this? A club full of a bunch of weirdos living in a city that's known to be full of weirdos. I love you so. And they're blasting all this raunchy and dirty, but clean dirty, you know, like playing on double entendres and stuff like that. And some of it was straight up dirtier. That music hit you in a spot that you couldn't really describe, but it made you want to do it. And there was something down there. As you're a kid, you can't put your finger on it yet, so to speak. I'm walking to all these dirty jokes.
I only remember the sex. I don't remember anything else about LA at all, frankly.
There was a kind of depravity going on in Los Angeles at that time. Quaaludes were really important to understanding 1970s rock and roll culture in California.
So I think everyone was into Quaaludes then, because you could. Quaaludes were a ridiculous drug, but everyone seemed to like them. They were young suburban kids out to wreak havoc and get the hell away from the suburbs and their parents. So this is a nutty time.
Again, this was coming out of Stonewall, the start of a gay liberation movement. The nuclear bomb has gone off in the nuclear family.
Bye. Bye. My mother and I used to go to the movies pretty much every weekend. We went to go see Cabaret. Really blew my mind. I loved Liza Minnelli. I loved the combination of the campiness, 1920s Germany and the flapper girl vibe. So obviously being around a place like Rodney's, that was campy too. It was exactly the sort of vibe in Cabaret. But whatever happened, Cabaret, Hollywood, and the idea about playing music all fused into one.
I always called Joan Jett and David Bowie time travelers because they're into all this music before it happens.
At one point, I met a girl. She wrote lyrics. Carrie Chrome, it was just another kid like me hanging out at the disco. And she said, you know, maybe you should talk to my publisher. His name's Kim Fowley. He called me up one day and, you know, so-and-so says you want to form a band. And I said, yeah, I want to form an all-girl band. I can't be the only girl in Hollywood that wants to do this. He said, well, do you have any demos? And I didn't even know what a demo was. A couple days later, it happened that Sandy West, who was the drummer of the Runaways, and she drove up with some friends to hang out at the Rainbow, or the Rainbow parking lot, which is a place where people go to watch stars. And people would hobnob and shoot the shit for a few hours, and she went up to him saying,
I said, hi, I play drums, and I'm in a band right now. He goes, how old are you? Well, I'm 15 and a half. And he says, you're kidding me. He goes, I'm working with a girl right now who's 14. I think she knows a friend out in the valley who plays electric guitar. It turned out to be Joan. She arrived a couple weeks later with her little Sears guitar in hand, 3 buses and 4 hours later from Canoga Park to Huntington Beach. She had such great rhythm that hit it off so well together.
Picked up the phone, called Kim, said, listen to this. And we played some sort of Chuck Berry-ish thing, or maybe Wild Thing. Man, Sandy, we really connected. That was the genesis of the Runaways. It was the heart.
What were your first impressions of L.A.?
It was Rodney and Kim Fowley walking down somewhere together.
Kim Fowley looked like Frankenstein if Frankenstein was on crack. He had produced a couple of very obscure novelty hits. I think he was involved with something called Alley Oop by the Hollywood Argyles. I always loved the song. There's a cat in the funny papers we all know. Alley Oop, 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 oop. He lived way back a long time ago, etc. He flirted around with working with me, and I didn't really want to get too involved. One day he said, well, I've got a group going, and they are the Runaways.
I said, Joan, let's go to the Sugar Shack because there'll be some girls out there who will know who you are.
We had a 3-piece lineup that we created in the first month, but I was so shy at this point, it was obvious I couldn't sing lead. You know, I was too shy, and I was embarrassed kind of to be on stage.
The whole room was full of miniature lipstick lesbian teenage girls, and then they had the gay boys who were mincing around. And a girl, Cherie Curry, walked up and in a stage whisper said, it's Joan Jett.
I had heard about the Runaways, and there was this little bit of a buzz going on about this teenage rock group. So when I met her, it was, I was a little, wow, it's Joan.
I said, you're either cruising here because you're a dyke, or you want to be the lead singer of the Runaways. Can you sing? Yes. Good. You're going to audition tomorrow. And then she brought her twin sister up. And I said, I'm not interested in a sister act. I'm interested in one Bridget Bardot fronting these screaming, loud, obnoxious, rebellious girls who can take over the world. And everybody had big smiles on their face. Yeah, 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 yeah.
The Runaways!
I think Sandy came across Lita by December of 75. The 3-piece was over, and we had Cherie and a bass player named Jackie Fox. When Cherie came to audition, and it became such an iconic song for the Runaways.
We were putting the Runaways together. It was based on Darwin. Let's start with the evolution of a man in show business. The guys just kept getting more and more and more and more feminine. Elvis was feminine. Sinatra was feminine. Bing Crosby was feminine. But if you keep getting more and more feminine, you're going to get to female. Duh.
What Jimi Hendrix said about women playing rock and roll, and when they do, they'll be looked at like aliens, in our case, is absolutely true.
If you look at the lyrics of the Runaways, you'll find that there is a openness that most teenage girls did not have in real life.
Everything happened really fast. We were playing gigs, we were in the studio, we just cut the tracks live. I was so into this idea of girls being able to play rock and roll and that they'll play as well as boys will. And girls playing rock and roll would be so cool and sexy because it's never been done. I thought everybody would love it. Once they realized it was serious and we planned to make an album and go on tour and do everything the male bands were doing, the tables turned where it went from, oh, cute, sweet, to slut, whore, cunt. I've been hurt. I've had my head split open by a beer bottle, a rib cracked by getting a battery thrown at me, like a big metal rig thing. Just because I was a girl, you know, get spit on. I mean, I just felt like I couldn't leave the stage. You know, I'd go off afterwards and cry, just because I didn't get it. And then I'd feel better after I'd, you know, cried a little bit, going, why? What's with that? People need to be so hateful, because you're playing rock and roll, you know? Some of the other girls got tired of it, and I don't blame them. It was just that, to me, felt like that's what I had to do. Tell me I can't do something, and you'll make sure I'm going to be doing it.
Hey, I heard a story, a rumor, someplace where you're rehearsing. What were you guys wearing during the rehearsal? I heard it was so hot, the air conditioner broke down, and...
What do you want to hear? You took off our band?
I remember early on, one of my first interviews, where people probably asked me about sex in the band, and I thought to myself, if I answer this question, that's all the Runaways music will ever be about, is sex. I have to talk about music. It has to be about music. Because just being girls, it exudes that sexuality. We don't have to talk about it.
They don't know what to say about an all-girl band besides the fact that we're just a band. They don't know where to put us. And so they just say, well, we're young. We sing about, you know, slightly outrageous things or rebellious things. So they stick us in that field.
I was sitting around my house and I found an old copy of Crawdaddy magazine. It was a review of the Runaways where the guy just slammed the shit out of them. The stuff he didn't like about them is all the stuff that everybody loves now. The fact that they were young and sexy and female.
We were all sort of rejects in terms of the industry. A lot of the criticism that was heaped on them was very negative and condescending and misogynistic.
Especially with mainstream press in like the mid-70s. You know, people are fucking stupid, and they'll do anything to create an article, to create some kind of outrage.
Rolling Stone hated the Runaways. The only time they wrote about us, Runaways get arrested and thrown out of Disney World. We were in a line, taking a photo, and we put our arms around each other walking. That's it. Lesbians out.
But if you listen to the Runaways, those are badass rock songs, and they kick the shit out of almost everything else that was out at that time.
Women were stepping out as rebels because women were getting pissed off in the culture. They were getting out there and kicking some heads. And the guys were turning into fags, and the women were turning into John Wayne.
Hey you, there's pretty things you got.
At this point, there were signs the women's lib movement was really taking root. It showed so much promise. All it meant to us was that we could do what we want.
We do it right, as long as we do it.
Kim took us to see Clockwork Orange and Rollerball. And afterwards, he turned to me and Sheree and said, that's what I want the Runaways to be. And what he did in rehearsal, you know, throwing stuff at us, calling us names, that was our boot camp. We were preparing for exactly what we walked into. Kim could come off like pretty intense, but I wasn't afraid of him.
Kim is the, you know, most controversial part of the Runaways. There are people who loved Kim, and there are people who actually despise him and think he was a kind of Satan.
My mother liked Kim, and he would be on the phone with her for hours. He talked to her a lot, you know? I mean, probably more than any of the other mothers, and was probably most friends with her. I think she felt reassured, but she also knew how the other mothers were hesitant. My parents told me I could be anything I wanted to be when I was like 5 years old, and I believed them. So that's the attitude as a young child that I took into life. I wanted to be an astronaut, I wanted to be an archaeologist, I wanted to do all different things. You know, I didn't realize really there was this glass ceiling. But when they got me that guitar for Christmas, the electric guitar, I was thinking most parents wouldn't do that.
She always had this inner confidence that she knew what she wanted. She didn't care what anybody else thought, even when she was young. And it's, you know, the single vision, and that's how she was, always.
My rebellion, as I said, was not against my parents. What I saw that society, with all this lip service to women and women's lib and all that, I saw that it was bull.
There were a lot of girls who didn't want to be Joni Mitchell. You know, they wanted to rock. The heaviest ones would drink with you, do everything with you, but they were always in that sidecar role. And then along came the Runaways. Joan Jett was nobody's sidecar.
Very male-dominated rock and roll scene in the 1970s, and that the women that were making music at that time were in kind of stereotypical singer-songwriter, had a different kind of cultural power. Rock radio did not play a lot of women artists. The FM stations at the time, only be one female artist on the air per hour. This was like a literal policy of radio stations.
How many radio stations are playing this kind of music in the United States now? Do we know?
There's, I would think, almost none. Maybe like one or two in New York, one or two in LA.
But from what I've read about it, there's no music. It's just chords and ranting and raving and put-downs.
No. It's more than that. I think it's a B-movie on record.
They were young, they were hot, and their music spoke about who they were and about their generation. I mean, it was heartfelt and mentally correct.
I feel it's a vacuum because we're living in a fragmented 70s where there's so many different things happening. That there isn't one Beatles or one Elvis Presley. It hasn't come yet. And here we are almost in 1980, and we're still looking over our shoulder to the 60s.
There's an inflection point in every generation where new ideas bubble to the surface and express themselves in new ways. The world had never seen a band like us. I felt that England got us more and did take us seriously.
We were selling out wherever we went.
They seemed to get it. Kids at my age in England had a much wider exposure to different kinds of music and would embrace it. The Sex Pistols were a huge part of the British punk scene. Got a chance to see some of the punk stuff up close. It really influenced me, so I kind of went over as a glitter person, came home dressed as a punk. Yeah, so I used to buy a lot of my accessories at a sex store, S&M, fetish store called The Pleasure Chest. I bought this great ring belt. I used to wear that. We were hanging out on a houseboat that we had rented for a month to record in London. Sid and Nancy came over to the houseboat one night, and he liked my belt, and so I gave it to him.
Nobody in the United States was wearing like safety pins on their leather jacket and all the chains and. You know, she was a real punk rocker in California. Nobody was a punk rocker. I mean, she lived that.
The Runaways from USA.
Thank you. We're really happy to be here.
When we got to Japan, you know, that's when I felt, wow, thousands of girls, like, treating like the Beatles. And I know it sounds funny, that's the only way you can describe it. They love their music stars over there, but it felt like we tapped into something else with female audiences. I thought it was exhilarating, but just because I thought that's powerful, man, it's all girls. The more I thought about it, I realized the way Japanese women are treated sort of like second-class citizens there. So these teenage girls were feeling the power of the Runaways saying, no, we can do it. The studio audiences went nuts.
Oh, God. Oh, boy. Okay, why don't you tell me about, or they all know you about very well, but why don't you tell me about how this band was made, huh?
It wasn't until Japan where we actually got a paycheck. We knew something was wrong when we weren't really getting paid and we'd have to ask for money for Tampax or a hamburger on the road. And there was always some excuse. But yet we were selling out everywhere, and there were the t-shirts and there were all the kids and the fans.
In the middle of the tour, we got this booklet. It was all color booklet. It said The Runaways, and there was like a tiny picture of all of us. And then it was like fold-out softcore porn shots of Sheree all the way through.
Kim made a very bad mistake. It's like he set up a photo session with the Japanese for me. Next thing I knew, there was a complete tour book with, you know, me and my corset.
We're like going, what the fuck is this? And we were all really annoyed by the fact that Sheree had done it and the fact that she didn't say anything to us.
And the girls really thought that I had done that myself. But Kim did things like that that caused damage to the band that just could not be fixed after a while. You know, they ended up not trusting me at all, and that caused me to separate myself a lot from the girls. And Joan and I had been very, very, very close. You know, Jackie had left from Japan, kind of a broken child, and I was the second to go.
After she left the band and after our Japanese tour, I didn't follow what she was doing right away. Obviously, there were parts of me that was very hurt by that, because we were close. You know, a band is like a family.
Oh! No! If you want to see Chabon, find Sheree, because we're fucking tired of that song.
Shortly thereafter that, they fired Kim Fowley.
You know, I think Kim's biggest mistake in life was not recognizing that Joan Jett was his great star and his great discovery.
Joan took over the front person's role, which she earned and which she deserved, but it changed the perception of the band by the industry, because the industry was so focused on Sheree and the blonde bombshell look. And that's haunted not just the music business, but all entertainment formats, you know, TV and film for years.
And what do you do when your iconic lead singer is gone, you know, and you gotta step up? It's kind of incredible that she, you know, had the balls to even do it.
So do you have a new record or anything coming out?
Nope.
Nothing?
No, we're going to Europe, right, like 2 days after the whiskey, and we're going to record in either London or Berlin.
We did Wasted on the TV show All Grey Whistle Test when we were in London. First time the Runaways were on TV with me as lead singer, which was really scary. Everything was just kind of splintering. I felt the album was going in a very heavy direction musically, and I could feel a camaraderie between Sandy, Lita, and this producer, John Alcott, and I was not part of it.
He drove a wedge between Sandy and Lita on the one side and Joan on the other. That destroyed the band.
You know, I'm not going to get fired from the band I started, so we're not on the same page, so I should probably let you guys do your thing. You know, we'd always been close enough to laugh and all that stuff, and you could tell those sort of elements were leaving, you know, where you felt like you had to walk on eggshells. And I didn't want to fight, you know, I loved these girls, you know. It was our baby.
I remember at the end of the Runaways period, she, you know, gained weight and was really bummed out as it was closing.
If they had had, you know, proper management, you know, they probably would have gone a lot further, a lot longer.
How did I personally deal with the crumbling of the Runaways? I drank a lot. Starting at 8 in the morning, not a good thing, and not a good way to deal with things. No, it got heavier than that. Definitely. Felt like L.A. was totally laughing at me, going, we told you it wouldn't work. We told you you couldn't do it.
She moved to Sunset and San Vicente in that weird house across from the Whiskey. It was decadent, honey. I would go by there, and it was like tons of people all over the living room, and I remember being with Chrissy Hynde, and Chrissy's like, honey, to Joan, you gotta pull it together.
Her friend Lisa called and said, Joan's very sick. I have to take her to the emergency room. She's sweating, she's very sick, something's wrong. And she had a heart infection, and she ended up in Cedars. And it was pretty scary.
I'm lucky I'm still here.
I know my mom was really worried about her. It was a really hard time. She was really depressed because she had high hopes for the Runaways.
It is funny that it's a heart infection because she did have a broken heart for losing the Runaways.
And I was angry. You know, I didn't know how to make sense of a world that would give girls shit for playing guitars. You know, I thought, you know, don't you guys have more important things to be upset about? I thought, you know, I'm gonna fucking kill myself. Accidentally, but I'm gonna do it. I gotta do something. What can I do? Maybe I'll join a branch of the military. Straighten up, learn something. I considered that because I didn't know what else to do. But we still had some legal obligations. We had signed to do the music for a movie. And even though the band wasn't together anymore, I cannot get sued. I can't afford to get sued. I need to write these songs.
I went through a few offers to produce them, and I wasn't really interested. Although I was intrigued by five crazy girls who were attractive, took a lot of drugs, made good music, and the band broke up, and they were teenage girls, so they didn't care about commitments or responsibility. I probably would have turned it down again. I was in England. Joan Jett was the only one left who was gonna live up to the commitment. They had 8 days to create 6 songs when Toby called me.
Before John Alcott, I had thought of Kenny Laguna as a guy who might produce this Runaways album. He blew me off. I went back to Kenny Laguna because I'm obviously a masochist, but I know you're a good songwriter, and I really think that you'd click with Joan.
My wife, Meryl, said to me, I've been reading about Joan Jett. I think she's significant.
I was in the studio with him, and I used to read Melody Maker and the NME, and there was a picture of the Runaways, and Joan just popped out of the picture. I said, I think this girl's got it.
And we went and stayed at the Riot House, the Hyatt House on Sunset. And Joan walked in the room with Toby, and I saw this girl with a black leather jacket, and she was a little beat up by then. She was drinking, she was hanging out with Sid Vicious and Steve Bates, Sid's girlfriend Nancy, and a bunch of people who all ended up dead. She had a sad look in her eye.
She was this lost waif, and your heart just went out for her because you could see she was so upset and destroyed by it.
You know, I was pretty much a mess.
Hi, guys.
But he saw something. I don't know what it was, you know? He bought me a pair of pants first, though. Because he couldn't write songs with a person with ripped jeans or something.
I head into the studio and I said, we'll cut the tracks with the session guys and then we'll put your guitar on. It's no big deal. She goes, then there won't be a record. And she wasn't kidding, but I dug it.
1, 2, 3, 4! So we fulfilled the contract. It wound up being like some weirdo porn movie, which was not what we signed up for.
There she is, Joni Jett. She's got the greatest voice I've ever seen, I've ever heard.
Now, I went out to California to meet Joan with a fellow named Richie Cordell. I said, you know, Richie, I think we can have hits with her. I think we should make her a partner.
And he goes, what, do you want to fuck her?
We're going to steal her money. I'll never forget it. But I knew that this girl should be a partner. She was that unique.
Things were definitely looking up. I felt good. I felt, okay, I've got someone to talk to write music with. Let's see where this goes. Yeah!
And then I took her to England. I had a flat in the King's Road, and every day we'd go to Ramport, the Who's studio, and record the Joan Jett record.
I was introduced to Kenny by a guy called Peter Meaden, a real character. And in so doing, he also came to me with an artist called Steve Gibbons. And Kenny produced the album for Steve Gibbons. They're a fantastic album. But the thing he's got extra is he's got great ears, he can produce, he knows what he wants.
I was born in the village, and my parents were predated hippies and beatniks. They were bohemian. They started me on piano lessons, 5 years old. I learned Mozart and Bach, and then I saw Jailhouse Rock, and he was doing art, and he still had a Cadillac, and that was all I needed to know. When I was about 16, I moseyed into New York City and started hustling. They gave me a songwriting job at Kama Sutra Records, and their specialty was bubblegum music. Which was coined by Neil Bogart, the great record exec.
Kenny Laguna did some great stuff pre-Joan. I don't know where we would have been without that guy. He was a bubblegum hero.
Our generation, when we were kids, that's what the music was.
No guilty pleasure. It's just like, look, we're making this music to make money. We're gonna sell it to kids. We're gonna turn it into, like, you know, records that are on the, literally the back of a cereal box.
All the songs were like about like naughty sexual things, but they sort of acted like they were about candy and bubble gum.
Yummy, 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 I got love in my tummy and I feel like I'm loving you. Love you such a sweet thing.
One of our little sayings was, don't bore us, get right to the chorus. Something weird happened. When the punks got on the scene, they didn't like Crosby, Stills, and Nash. They hated Neil Young. They thought those bands were pretentious.
I'm a hook guy. I think Kenny and I share that. Like, I like a hook. Problem with bubblegum is that sometimes it was so saccharine. For me, it's almost unlistenable.
There was a lot of shared DNA between bubblegum and punk. Bubblegum was short, to the point, little songs with hooks and an ass-kicking beat.
And that was punk.
I was making 100 grand when I was 17. I remember my father said, you should try to save some money. And I said, I can have a hit anytime I want. By the time I was 19, bubblegum died. But we wanted to be cooler than bubblegum. I did a soundtrack album for Andy Warhol, Lonesome Cowboys. And I used orchestration. I was putting horns on and then strings. So without much of a plot line. Just very effeminate guys dressed as cowboys hanging out together. And I remember giving a spiel to Andy Warhol and Paul Morrissey about the art. And Morrissey said, don't talk to us about art. We hired you because we want money. It's very shocking to me because I grew up with artists who thought it was gauche to want money.
I really liked Kenny from the first moment I met him. I don't know why. I always have. I remember saying to Kenny, maybe getting a bit bored, I don't know, but just saying, you know, go talk to Bill.
Stop all this shit.
Oh, Bill! Oh, my God! How you doing?
What's all this shit?
What affected me was their self-belief. But under the self-belief, there's a fear, oh, is it ever going to happen, or are we ever going to get a break? And for me, life's about that.
And Bill said to Kenny, you know what, why don't you just go into our studio, Ramport, do what you gotta do, and pay us when you can.
Now I'm in business.
And that was the start of their relationship and ours.
I'll tell you all about this girl. I'll tell you the truth about this girl.
It felt like you were kind of blessed by, you know, the rock and roll gods. And then we're like, well, we want to tour this music, because it's great. So we need to form a band. And went back to L.A., put an ad in the L.A. Weekly or something, and said, Joan Jett, looking for 3 good men.
I remember very clearly going to the audition. I knew all the Runaway songs because as a 13-year-old kid, 14-year-old kid, I'd been at home playing along with the records. And Joan knew me from the punk scene.
I kind of knew in my gut that there was no way I could play with girls again. Certainly not right away, because it would only be compared to the Runaways, and that was not good on any level.
We got the Whiskey a Go-Go, and we picked the worst night of the week, which was Tuesday, and we played there every week for a month. And by the time we were done with that, we were on the map there in L.A. All of a sudden, there's a lot of chicks here. I'm like kind of getting into it. And then by the last gig, I was like, well, wait a minute. They're looking at her.
You've got this weird punk rocker who has an extraterrestrial good voice. And then you have someone who's worked in the business of making bubblegum music. I was caught so unaware
when you made it all the same. She brought menace, and I brought a lot of pop sensibility.
Mix that together and you've got like a Molotov cocktail that's gonna like totally do some damage.
First one we wrote was, you don't know what you've got till it's gone. To me, it was, you know, Kenny was taking my life, you know, I guess being a therapist.
And the more we knew each other, the more she trusted me. Whereas Joan sort of needs to experience heartache to write about it.
Kenny actually was looking for record deals, so Kenny would send the tapes in. We sent it to all the labels, all the majors, all the minors. It was 23 labels, and we got back 23 rejection letters, all saying, you need a song search, no songs here. Maybe if she loses the guitar. These people heard five songs, four of which were top 20 hits. That can't be a song search. That's, you don't have ears.
We asked for no money.
Just put out the record. I know it had something to do with my image, the Runaways, the girl. I think Kenny thought it was gonna be a lot easier than it ultimately turned out to be.
My mom was an outrageous feminist. She used to drive the car. And my father sat where everybody else's mother sat. So when I met Joan and heard about the Runaways, I never really thought it was like weird or groundbreaking until I tried to promote her. And I ran into these walls, these brick walls. An interviewer who once said to her, when you're playing on stage, do you feel like a man or a woman? And I was like, what?
Could you ever see yourself getting married?
No. I mean, you know, I don't like to knock the American dream or anything.
Do you ever want to have children?
No. If you really want to be a musician, now that's where you got to really do some soul searching and decide, do I want to be a musician or do I want to be a flash in the pan and ride limos for a week? Now you got to decide what you want to do with your life.
Kenny Laguna came over and he literally pulled out the map. He's like, look, here's Boston, New York, Washington, D.C. Look at all these towns.
In L.A., there's a limited amount of cities you can hit when you're a poor band and you're struggling, making every penny count.
He just convinced us on the spot that we would move to New York.
It was a circuit. There was the Rat in Boston, the Malibu in my father's place, Privates and the Ritz in New York, the Left Bank in Westchester, these places that were incubators for rock bands. And they'd give you $500. Didn't cover much.
But you had a lot more opportunity to play and survive.
We got a minor deal in Europe. That was the beginning, but we couldn't get anything going in America. And all of a sudden, we find out that we are the number one import. The record's on the radio, and nobody wants to be our label.
Now, I'm seeing something going on that I can't put my finger on, but I know we're tapping into something. So it gave me the courage to empty our bank account. My daughter was just born. She was only a couple of months old. And we started a college fund, so there was like $3,000 or $4,000 in there. I mean, it was like I had jumped off the diving board, and I was hoping somebody was gonna put water in the pool.
But we discussed about printing, you know, well, let's print up these records. We'll make our own records. Nobody's gonna sign us. We'll take this music we believe in so much and just do it. Our first office was more or less Kenny's big, huge Cadillac.
Anyway, so we had this big old 1976 sedan DeVille. We used to always have records in the trunk.
You know, we'd hang out and there'd be a little crowd of 30 or 40 people and we'd sign autographs, and then if anybody wanted the record, we had the trunk full of albums.
And it wasn't done. In those days, you did not sell records at gigs.
It wasn't part of the landscape yet.
And that was the beginning of Blackheart Records.
They're not getting any traction, and they're like, well, fuck it, we'll put out our own records. I don't know if that came out of a punk aesthetic. Maybe it did. Or maybe it was just that they were just punks before they knew it.
Oh, you mean I don't need to have someone trying to discover me? I can actually just do this myself?
In the beginning, the first gig we did was at the Malibu in Long Island. 54 people came. 25 of them were my guest list from my neighbors.
The next time we played there, they had to shut down the Southern State Parkway.
That Joan and Kenny have done things, it inspired people to make their own labels. Because people figured out that they don't need a bunch of guys in suits and cigars and cash to start a label.
And I think it was in a bar in upstate New York, and a big tour manager, I'll never forget him saying this, because at this club, the line was around the block. And when we got in, he said to me, remember these days. This is the best time you're ever gonna have. And never take it for granted. And I never have.
Yeah. Fuck you!
Is that something that gnaws at you, the fact that they'll take you seriously fronting a male band, but they wouldn't take you seriously being an all-girl band?
I think audiences are forced to listen more, and they're more accepting than maybe the business. Like, I think the record companies haven't come far at all until, like, women get in the position of A&R men.
Oh, I'm sure she had to go through a lot of, you know, I can play guitar just as good as you can, motherfucker, you know? Just because I'm a girl, don't think I can't play.
I know very few men that can play like her. You know, she's ferocious when she plays that guitar.
Out of nowhere, an old friend of mine, the head of Buddha, Neil Bogart, decided to help us.
Neil ran Casablanca Records, which had Kiss, but they were a disco label, basically.
I mean, this guy knew senators and presidents and made movies.
He was really into what we were doing, and that was so different. I liked it because it felt like he was shoving it up people's ass.
He helped me put out the Joan Jett record, which he renamed Bad Reputation. He never checked with us. It completely pissed us off. He said, you're a cult marketer. I'm a mass marketer. I have two Rolls Royces. That makes me a lot smarter than you, Kenny. We were selling so many more records than we knew about because the factory was printing them up and selling them out the back door. You gotta be very careful how you handle it because the guys doing that are bugs. So you don't sue them. Neil knew how to handle that. We went and we took our own money and made all of rock and roll. And people just didn't do that. You know, I mean, not today, it's common.
I had seen this song that was a B-side of another song. I saw it on TV. It was called I Love Rock and Roll. And I'm like, that's a hit. And the Runaways didn't want to do it. And so I did a version with the Sex Pistols and Steve Jones and Paul Cook.
I thought their version was a little unsophisticated, a little sophomoric. I thought we could make a better record.
So once I was with Kenny and we formed the Blackhearts, it was something that I wanted to try. And the rest is history.
Singing, I love rock and roll. So
MTV started around the same time we were starting.
I was brought up to believe television's the enemy of rock and roll.
Les Garland started harassing me. He was one of the heads of MTV. And he just begged me, and I said, okay, but you're only allowed to play it 2 times a day. He was playing it 16 times a day and freaking me out, but there was very little I could do about it. It was number one for 8 weeks. But I felt that, in retrospect, the second 4 weeks was probably number one because all of a sudden the image went on.
I mean, I love rock and roll. Of course I love rock and roll. I'm in. I was like, I kind of wanted to be like, you know, the guy version of that.
It was kind of a aha, I told you so, in a way, but look, it's real, we're good. It wasn't I'm good, it's we're good. It's a team, it's an effort, a team effort, and we all go out there to make this music.
Things rapidly changed immediately after that.
Through the United States to Canada, Japan, and Australia.
Joan Jett.
Joan Jett and the Blackhearts.
We just traveled the world.
La gran estrella del rock and roll, Joan Jett.
We went down to Panama, you know. It's like, if there's trouble, we go. So we get there, and we get a message. Noriega wants Joan, and he sends his plane to pick up Joan. He didn't really tell him no. And we're trying to weasel out, but luckily for us, less lucky for him, there was some bad incident happened and it saved our asses because he was serious. He wanted to meet Joan Jett.
David Bowie and Freddie Mercury came up on stage to watch Joan.
I mean, we're talking like 80,000 seats or something in Leeds, England. A few years earlier, I was listening to on the radio, you know, and all of a sudden you're on stage with him.
The fame and everything didn't affect her like I thought it would. She didn't care about the press conferences and the parties and this and that. To her, playing was what it was all about.
It was like you were always 1 foot in the gutter and 1 foot in possible stardom. I can't even figure out how to say it. It was surreal, so surreal. It went so far beyond me, it made me realize what people can do in general if the circumstances are right.
First time I heard Joan, I was in the car with my dad, and it came on the radio, and it was Crimson and Clover. And I heard that voice, and I was just like, who is this person? And then when she would get to the pronouns, and say she, I got really interested. Crimson and clover. You could sing like a song about really caring about another girl. Yeah. Because my friendships were so important to me at that age that I was like, somebody gets me.
It's that sort of, oh my God, she's gonna take me home and fuck the shit out of me. And it's scary, and it's not what people grew up with, and they're used to being the dominant one, and they're not used to girls using their sexuality in a way that they feel they own it.
You can use this as saying, oh, well, people just want to play music, and they don't want it to become about their sexuality, even if whatever they're wearing or whatever they're doing, but sometimes you do want to fucking be sexual, and I think there's this thing that women are supposed to act like we don't want to fuck too, and that we don't like sex too, that only guys like to fuck, that we don't like to have sex.
The music scene was a total boys' club. The analogy I always made was Mick Jagger came out in Madison Square Garden riding on a giant inflated cock. And if Debbie or Joan had come out riding a giant inflated pussy, all the fucking male critics would have been running, screaming for the exits.
If Mick Jagger can transcend his sexuality, so does Joan Jett. You know what I mean?
It gives you power to prove everyone wrong. There's a huge energy in that. It's so valuable.
to have something to fight against. I think the attitude is a really big one. I think that's impossible to miss, you know. I wouldn't know how to go and get Joan's sound because I'm not technical in that way, but the attitude I pick up on right away. And that's something that I want in my head and my heart when I'm going out there to do that thing that's so scary in front of all those people.
Well, because rock and roll is from the waist down, if you're doing it right.
Neil died, unfortunately, of cancer at 39 years old in 1982.
And at his funeral, his mother grabbed Joan and said that record meant more to Neil than all the other hundreds of hits he had had. He said, see, I can do rock and roll.
Boardwalk went out of business,
and we moved to MCA Records.
It was the beginning of Irving Azoff's tenure there. MCA gave us a multi-million dollar deal, and while Irving was brilliant, they weren't really ready for a rock and roll band.
The album known as Album didn't do as well as I Love Rock and Roll. And the label kind of started kicking the shit out of us. And then we had a urban contemporary, pretty big hit with Everyday People.
Joan ran around with the Commodores and the Temptations and Frankie Crocker.
There's the yellow one that won't accept the black one that won't accept the red one that won't accept the white one. It's yellow, black, red, white.
And then Glorious Results came out. And by then, we were fighting with MCA, and they kind of buried that record.
The rock business is for people who can't do anything properly, which only a schmuck would do.
The situation at MCA became so acrimonious that they actually did something unthinkable. They actually went out in the street to try to stop people from playing our records to teach us a lesson, and that was unconscionable. It's one thing when they're not helping you at all. It's another thing when they're coming after you and trying to hurt you. That's hard to overcome.
So what happened? We were hot, 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 and now we're cold, cold, cold. We felt like we're back to square one. Now, we could still sell out almost any club in America, but a lot of people left us for dead.
It's not gonna be so easy this time, Patty. You're gonna have to prove yourself. From what I can see, you're not a fit mother.
I'd always wanted to act since I was a kid. And then out of left field, I got an offer to do a movie. It was called Light of Day.
There's a young woman in rock and roll today who has long had the respect of her peers, and now she's breaking out into the mainstream.
And since when are you an authority on fit mothers? Since when are you an authority on anything?
Wait.
I ain't staying in this house.
How did Kenny put it? A rock and roll cancer movie. Paul Schrader. Of the movie Taxi Driver and movies like that. I wrote this movie and was also directing it.
People haven't done a lot of acting, but they're natural performers. It's because they're able to access stuff. They're able to go to places and look at things from a different angle. And it's kind of rock hard and stoic as Joan may seem. She's a very curious person, and she would test the limits of where she thought she could go and think of bringing new things and new emotions. And I've seen other actors manufacture and summon up for roles. But you'd always see the work behind it. Whereas with Joan, she just had that.
I told her, I warned her, I was real clear. I told her if she mentioned church or rock and roll or marriage, I'd walk out of the room if I was in it, hang up the phone if I was on it. She can't bring up those subjects no more.
It was just prayer.
Yeah, that's her trick. Thought she could get away with it. No way, man. There's no middle ground. It's her or me.
And when she'd get there, it'd be scary, whether she was acting or she was playing. I mean, they'd get to a place where you just don't fuck around. Just let her do what she's doing, and I hope you don't get hurt.
Bruce Springsteen wrote the title song for the movie. Initially, Bruce was supposed to play my role.
Sensitive and emotional and things like loyalty and friendship mean a lot to her and empathy. And those are all great qualities for an actor.
He said that you were very patient with him, and he got the sense that as long as he took what he was doing seriously, then you wouldn't have a problem with him.
Yeah, we treated each other as peers in each other's worlds, which was, I thought was very helpful.
The relationship between your label and yourselves, I think, was encapsulated by Neil Bogart, who said to me, think of me as your surgeon. And if you piss me off, you're gonna die. We were a really small boutique label. Big Star Machine is available to you if you're on Warner Brothers or Columbia. And that was what Joan missed for most of her career, because that Star Machine makes the difference. So there was a part of me that always wanted the major. So when we went to Epic, we had our little honeymoon. And then once again, we had this monster kind of holding us back. Like mad dogs, Joan toured herself to death. I was working day and night, going to radio stations, taking everybody out, buying televisions for their kids in their dorms, you know, whatever I could think of to get an edge. And somehow we kept that record alive for 17 weeks. And then we were back and we had friends again.
Washington, D.C., only 2 miles from the White House, store owners prepare for another night of civil unrest.
In the summer of 92, it was a riot in the Mount Pleasant neighborhood of Washington, D.C. And that neighborhood was filled with punk group houses. There was a lot of women who were very, like, political. This woman, Jen Thomas, said, we should have a girl riot. Someone said, we should be Riot Girls. That was sort of the beginning of the Riot Girl movement, or whatever you want to call it.
Two girls, Toby and Kathy, from my band Bikini Kill, went to see a Fugazi show.
And Joan and Kenny came down for the gig. And Joan's like, you can see her in the back of this, you know, on the side of the stage just going off.
So they got one of our demo tapes. They must have had one in their bag or something. And then they wrote, for a good time, call. And they wrote my phone number. Phone rings, and I pick it up, and it's like, hey, Kathleen, it's Joan Jett. And I was just like, yeah, whatever. Who the fuck is this? No, I was at the Fugazi show last night. She's like, I heard a demo of your band. I think it's really great. I think maybe we could work together. And I was just like, this really is not funny. So I walk into the living room and we have this glorious misspent youth poster. And I said, okay, if you're really Joan Jett, tell me what your hair looks like. And she goes, it's like a bastardized, disheveled bob. And I was like, oh shit, you are Joan Jett.
I got such a kick out of watching them fight their fight. Because their fight was my fight.
I'm not willing to deal with the mainstream anymore when they're constantly asking me questions about sexual abuse, about if I've been a stripper, if I haven't been a stripper, constantly just completely sexist shit.
And probably, and then on another level, she related to it because she's a woman, you know? And she had been, of all people, in the trenches in an era where women were, like, you know, so marginalized.
I wanted to use music to spread feminism, and I thought punk was a great vehicle. I mean, I equated being on a major label with, like, oh, I'm gonna, you know, start using drugs and die. Kim and Thurston from Sonic Youth were really nice to us and would let us crash on their floor, but Joan was the person who stepped forward and said, I wanna be involved. She really understood where we were coming from.
For lack of a better term, you know, an updated version of what the Runaways were trying to achieve, some kind of legitimacy.
She kind of was the cement that kept a lot of things going for some of the feminist bands in the 90s, definitely for me. I mean, she changed my whole career path and taught me how to record a record.
When they did that Bikini Kill record, they produced that record, which is, I think, the best Bikini Kill record. Joan's name is on there, but Kenny's really, he's involved. He's working. You know, he's always in the studio. I have to say, this kind of ties in Joan pretty intensely, is that, like, I hadn't heard of the Runaways. One of the earliest scenes that we were really interested in was the LA punk scene. And then the Germs album came out. That record was hugely significant for us. And Joan had produced it. Oh, wait a minute, that's the I Love Rock and Roll person. Like, that's crazy that she produced this record.
She has been a part of not only her own music that she's produced, but also some of the greatest punk music that's ever been put out.
We have a few friends for you to meet. Mercury recording artist Joan Jett of the Runaways. And we have with us tonight the Germs performing at the Whiskey. What are you guys gonna do tonight?
Same stuff we always do.
Touch the tears.
The Germs, they were a pretty infamous L.A. punk band. The lead singer, Darby Crash, and the guitar player, Pat Smear, were huge Runaways fans. Eventually, they start this band called The Germs, and they're, you know, hardcore punk.
Darby was some kind of crazed Colonel Kurtz-like shaman of teenage people.
It must have been 79 at some point before I moved. They asked if, you know, if I would produce an album. And I'm figuring, you know, they think I know what I'm doing because I've made a couple albums with the Runaways.
She didn't engineer. That wasn't her thing. Had a great sensibility. She's like, I think you got to tune the guitar, Pat.
It was a no-frills album, but just straight up punk rock. I was very proud of the record.
We needed someone with ears and someone with a rock and roll heart, you know, and they're helping us make a good record. And she did that, by gosh. She knew how to get us to do the things.
And I think the last day I partied too much and passed out on the couch, which Darby documents in one of the songs.
Since 1991, the hottest spot in rock and roll has been Seattle, Washington. Nirvana, Pearl Jam, and Alice in Chains all came out of the local music scene. Many people thought the next breakthrough band would be the Gits, a punk rock group fronted by Mia Zapata, a charismatic 27-year-old with a tragic destiny.
Two of her roommates finally broke down and called the morgue where she was. And she was an unidentified victim at the morgue at that time.
She was found strangled to death by her hoodie tie, raped and left in an alley.
Somehow came up in the studio with Joan, and she's just like, we gotta do something. We gotta be involved. Next thing you know, she's like singing the Gits songs with the surviving members of the Gits.
The thing that really struck me really hard at the time was how it could have been any one of us, and how many times, you know, I've come home late at night in that exact same situation. She could have been me, and I could have been her.
He comes right after, then he slapped you right across the face, and there's no singing, you know, so it's like it emphasizes that.
It was a very strange thing, because it was, you're celebrating the music, but it was about such a horrible thing.
It's gonna blow their minds.
Really good, huh?
Keep going.
How did you guys make that very painful decision to keep on playing?
Because Mia would be really upset if we didn't.
When you see the footage and you see how close they were, and you see Andy and Mia joking on stage, and you see this rapport and how close they were, I mean, it really had to be devastating, you know?
To Viva Zapata. Thank you for supporting.
It was all the money went to charity.
To help protect women walking home, self-defense classes, all kinds of stuff. It was a big deal at the time because women were getting raped.
Well, it was also murdered, to contribute money for the private eye because
to find the guy that killed Mia. Still never forget the day I got a phone call from Steve Moriarty. No hello, no nothing. We got him.
The mid-90s, you know, when we were doing all of these one-off shows, we'd be going to a crappy little town, doing a state fair. Not really L.A., but 3 hours outside of LA. I went through a phase where I didn't really give a crap. Because there were, you know, gigs that I felt we shouldn't have been doing, or whatever.
Our business is funny. You're hot and important, and then you're not.
It was a bad feeling, but I always felt like we had to fight on. We knew we had what it took. We didn't stop working, and so
it was not fun.
Unless you've been gifted
in your 20s with incredible piles of money being thrown at you by the system, which almost all really, really good musicians are not. You need to exert incredible focus on maintaining your own identity while still using the skill to enter the system without destroying yourself as a force.
You have to be really willing to go anywhere with it, up or down, you know, sideways, whatever.
Joan, she gives it 100%, whether it's a state fair, a sweet 16 birthday party, or 10,000 people. She still gives it her all, no matter what.
I saw her live at a summer music festival here in Las Vegas, 110 degrees out, full leather, up on stage, just ripping it apart. Because this was mid-90s to late 90s. We ended up doing some private thing together. I was like, man, I forgot how badass Joan Jett was, you know?
Rock and roll animal, I mean, if there's ever anyone that fit that description, it's Joan, through and through.
I would say our period during the 90s was the most difficult. If it was our fate to split up, it would have been then, but we stuck together.
Pretty scary sight, right?
It's a beautiful thing.
You know what? I'm not trying to tell you how to do lights or anything.
No,
but doesn't it get cold in the middle of the show?
We've got a band here from New York City. They've been performing for soldiers for 18 years.
I wasn't for the Vietnam War, but I also had people in my family, like my godfather, uncle, and dad, who said, you have to serve your country. So I started doing stuff for the troops.
I feel it's really important to give back and serve on some level. And since I didn't in that capacity, I feel like that's the least I can do.
I never connected the troops with the policy.
We put on a show, packed house in Tuzla, Bosnia, and you could see her opening up, trying to understand what the people in that region had been through, a very bloody three-year conflict.
I'm an anti-war person who loves people in the military. It's not, I don't like the military for the military's sake.
Isn't it scary that kids fight the wars?
Yeah. It's scary that there's war.
Isn't it?
It's scary that they're fighting because they're two religions and they can't just be curious about each other instead of dominant over one another. Long ago, we decided that was the tack we were going to take as a species, you know, that we were going to dominate instead of sort of merge.
When 9/11 happened, the first thing I thought of was, we gotta get over there. They said they didn't want the band. They wanted just Kenny and I. They wanted to keep the footprints light. People just were incredulous. Why are you here? And we said, we're here because you're here. We just want to say thank you.
The way she interacted, there was nothing artificial about it. Others would come, put on a show, and leave. Joan stayed. I got so much positive feedback about how she made them feel.
And oh my God, I have to say this. You lifted up your arm and you've got hair under your armpits and no hair on your head. I love that. It's genius. It's genius.
You sound like my producer, Kenny Laguna.
Will you show that again?
Now what are you doing?
Why can't you guys get off my back?
Because it's such a lovely back.
Do you want to lick it?
No, I don't want to lick it.
There's no hair on it.
I don't care.
It's almost like watching The Odd Couple a little bit, but there's something about those two. There's a special bond and chemistry that they have between them.
Kind of like George and Gracie in reverse or something.
Can't you just keep your thoughts to yourself? For once, you've been saying the same thing over and over and over and over all day since I woke up.
Because you said as soon as I went to hand you the thing,
Then you had to storm out.
I'm not arguing with you anymore.
You can tell there's like a deep love for each other and that they're inseparable people.
They're alter egos in a way, aren't they? They're twins from different fathers. It's just in a sense. And I guess that happens with most good friendships.
Because I think people get so stuck on relationships being a sexual relationship or having to be a romantic relationship.
What is it with your best friend that you hit things off with so easily? You actually know what the other guy's thinking. You tune in. And I suppose that's what they've got going for them.
People don't find this in the life partners. People don't have the love they have in marriages. That's why they don't stay together as long in Kitty and Joan.
It's a marriage without the sex, really. It's a mental marriage.
People literally are fucking married to people that they hate. And then you see these two.
I'm putting this on just so it'll be done for the future.
Oh, this is going in the trash.
Okay. No, it's not. I'm sending it to Caesar.
No, he'll just make another one,
Kenny. I don't care. I'm sending it to him. Maybe
no, you're not. He won't be able to get the tape off, and it'll mark up the stuff. He's not gonna do. I know him. Don't give me a fucking face.
Kenny is just—he's just a classic New York dude that just loves music, and he's a really caring person that loves Joan and just loves rock music and just wants it to just prevail.
Out, please. I gotta get changed.
Yep, I'm sending it to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It's the one you almost wore.
He's a hardcore feminist man. He is totally just a contrarian. And he likes to fuck with everything anybody says ever.
They're family with each other. And they're interdependent on each other. I mean, they really are partners.
Sure, it's dysfunctional. Everything's dysfunctional. But it's like, it's my kind of dysfunctional.
And people want to tell, I guess, everyone how to be and who to love. But you can't help who you love. And you can't help what your relationship is with them either.
Whenever they appear to be at odds, just wait until it blows over, because it does. It blows over and 10 minutes later, not even 5 minutes later, and they're acting like it never happened.
Best friends are supposed to annoy you a little bit. They gotta push your buttons a little. They keep you alive.
So it's an extraordinary situation. You won't see another one like it, really.
So the years went by. Even though we were having some profile, we were not making money. Carrie Ann came back from Colorado, and Carrie came on board.
When I got there, my father was ready to sign Rick Derringer's Christian album. It was Rock and Roll Hoochie Coo, and instead of Rock and Roll Hoochie Coo, it was Jesus Christ Hoochie Coo. My father always had this philosophy of, if they're a friend, we will put it out.
You know, she was like, I'll stick around, but we got to treat this like a real label. And she had grown up in the business, but also had the attitude of a young person. Like, I didn't want iTunes. iTunes to me was the enemy. I'm selling I Love Rock and Roll for $17. I don't want to sell it for a dollar. She finally talked me into doing it, and the first month we sold 70,000 I Love Rock and Roll downloads, and we were in business.
Carrie came in and boom, 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 boom.
Had a meeting with Kevin Lyman, who owns the Warped Tour. The Warped Tour was this hip thing, and it was kind of a weird concept for Joan to go on the Warped Tour.
I think at that point, Joan was not feeling as inspired, and my father too. I didn't see the fire that I saw after the Warped Tour. It reignited her, and it reignited the passion.
How's everybody doing? Wow, look where we are. This is so pretty. I was actually born in Pennsylvania, so
and you're traveling around the U.S. and playing in parking lots. I'm like, whoa, Joan Jett and the Blackhearts are gonna be on this tour? Like, Joan's a real rock star, and we just all wanna be rock stars. I just, like, will forever have that mental image of Joan on her BMX bike with camo cut-off shorts and big black sunglasses just riding around hanging out with everyone.
You could just see she was having fun, and she was reminded of what it was in the beginning.
Like, your motivations in order to survive doing something like that can't be like fame and fortune. You know, it has to be the overall package of like, I'm going to be good at every single element of this or work at every single element of it. Seeing that as a younger musician at the time, you know, those are the people I want to learn from.
From there, we found our voice. We found our next chapter.
She runs the company now. And I think that's just a beautiful cycle of life, and you see it right in front of you.
We wanted to be a place that said yes to people and gave a platform for young bands that didn't fit into any kind of typical major label box.
There's a lot of bullshit going on right now with a dum-dum in office. So we're musicians. We have a platform. People paying attention to our music and lyrics. She's always let us speak freely because she does so herself.
So in my final state of the state, I was giving advice to the new governor that I've taken from someone who I admire. And they all know that I love Joan Jett. And so I just gave one of her quotes where she said, you know, be yourself. That's the way it's supposed to be.
A lot of musicians, entertainers, they develop a degree of success and notoriety from their work. And frequently they're less inclined to take a stand because that might alienate a segment of their audience. Joan, on the other hand, is very outspoken.
When I came out in 2012 as transgender, Joan was one of the first people to contact me to just say, like, hey, you know, if you need a friend or someone to talk to, I'm here.
Well, now, don't get him wrong, and don't get him mad. He might be a father, but...
And it really, it meant a lot to me, you know? There were a few people that I felt like I could relate to at that time, and a few people that... You know, I felt like I had any kind of shared experiences with, not just like being in a band, but when talking about gender fluidity.
Androgynous, closer than you know, love each other so.
I know she championed for women's causes and LGBTQ causes, and that's all great, but I don't think she's mushy about it. She's straightforward about it, and this is the way it should be, and fuck you if you don't see it that way.
A Cupid doll.
I wish that more people who were in a position to use their voice beyond just the art that they create, would do that.
The way we interact with animals says a lot about who we are. When we treat them with cruelty, it says something. When we treat them with kindness, it says something very different.
The way our culture thinks about animals or doesn't think about them and their lives and how they think and that they feel pain and that they scream.
Well, you know, chickens recognize each other by their faces.
Yeah.
Just like we do.
What do you want Norway to do?
Stop supporting the seal slaughter in Canada.
Joan has always shown up. She speaks out for animals. She speaks out for people who don't have enough of a voice. Most people don't think about it.
Animal rights is human rights. You know, humans are animals. And we all have the capacity to feel pain, to feel fear, to suffer.
And I'm not trying to demonize people that do eat meat, and I try not to preach to them, but I do talk to people about it if they're curious.
What are you writing? What are you doing? Where you been? How you doing?
Well, between watching The View, because I watch it. Yeah. Every day.
I did a movie. I executive produced a film about my first band called The Runaways, right, that had Kristen Stewart, right, Dakota Fanning in it.
In a rehearsal before we actually shot Cherry Bomb, I was like, couldn't commit to it. Just felt like I was traipsing on something. Like, I'm not good at rehearsal. So she was like, what are you doing, man? Like, come on. You know this, you got this. And I was like, I know, I do got it, don't worry. And she's like, come on, man, pull it through the fucking wood. And I was like, all right. It's funny, because like rock and roll is supposed to be like messy and like, fuck it, nothing matters. But it's truly the opposite of that for her. She has like a diligent, almost like compulsive, like dedication to it. And that was just like, Kristen, pull through the wood. I think the most surprising thing is just how emotional she is. And I guess in retrospect, it makes total sense. You look at the music and it definitely has this like kind of precious, gritty, girly, feminine snarl that could only come from somewhere that's a little self-protective.
So here is a lady who I can't believe is not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, who should be. Ladies and gentlemen, Joan Jett.
We all have our fucking heroes, you know? And we made friends with one of our fucking greatest rock and roll heroes. She made Pat want to fucking start a band. Made it okay to be fucking dirty and cool and play rock and roll like a real rock and roller.
I'm worse at what I do best. For this gift I feel blessed. Our little group has always been and always will until the end.
Home because you were wearing a fucking cape, and now you're not gonna wear the cape?
Well, you can wear the cape.
Can I wear her cape?
Yes.
Depending on what you think is a normal, regular life, being in a band, you know, you're pretty much all consumed with it, yeah. Is that healthy? I don't know. I'm not a doctor. Probably not super. But, you know, it's what I enjoy. I think it makes it sort of difficult to have relationships. I would think that would probably be, I guess if you call it a sacrifice, that would be it. To say music is my mate would be a pretty fair statement. And I get a lot from it. But it's not a person. And I think I know the difference.
I'm gonna start off this induction with the first time I wanted to have sex with Joan Jett. And we were doing Oprah together, and I go up to Joan's hotel room, and Joan opens the door, and I come in, and Kenny Laguna is laying in bed. And I don't know what the fuck is going on.
No. Oh, that's beautiful. You look beautiful. Look at
that's
him.
That's it. You're wearing the cape. Squeamy Jay Hawkins.
I know there isn't one other person on this planet that's been an inspiration to me like you have. And,
is being famous important to you?
I want a certain sort of fame. Like when they write the ultimate rock and roll history book, you know, I want my name to be there, you know, as standing for something, like being one of the first females to really, you know, play rock and roll and have that sort of rock and roll spirit.
I think people don't think of her like, oh, you know, feminist, like immediately. But the visceral experience of Joan is a feminist experience for me. Watching the way she holds herself like a normal person, not like someone who's self-conscious and, you know, trying to be a good girl. Here's somebody who is born to do this and is doing it.
There's just those rare times where you feel like someone was put on the planet to show you what rock and roll music is. It could be Bowie, it could be Kurt Cobain, and it's definitely Joan Jett.
I was really gonna try not to cry and be tough, but that's a little overwhelming there. Thank you very much. First off, I really want to acknowledge my parents, Jim and Dottie, who can only be with us in spirit, which I know they are. Hey, Mom and Dad, did you ever think that Christmas guitar would lead to this? I want to be a release. I want to be a hard release, a good release, a primal release. You do a primal scream, but it's not at someone or breaking something. It's just into the air about appreciation of being alive, you know?
This is a family that's been together since 1979 and never wavered from each other.
It's all of us, and we all get support and love and strength from each other and feel like we can go to each other when we need to. And I think that's really important, to be able to feel vulnerable to the people you work with and be able to feel like they've got your back. If you want to get really deep, there are no two things. We're all one.
I want to tell a story about Joan, be a wonderful woman. I want to tell you a story about how people say that she opened the door for women in rock, and I don't think she opened the door. I think she took out a sledgehammer and she knocked down the whole damn wall. You're living in the past, it's a new generation. And a girl can do what she wants to do, and that's what I'm gonna do. And I don't give a damn about my bad reputation.
Sometimes I feel like it's all too much. Sometimes I wonder what are we in.